I would ask the clerk to take the roll, please. Brewer?
Here.
Steve?
Here.
Glassburger?
Here.
Miller? Dentist? Turk?
Here.
Cosgrove?
Here.
Gray? And Fleming?
Here.
We have a call.
Excellent.
Was it properly noticed? Yes, Mr. Chair, the meeting properly.
Thank you.
We have before us a 12-point agenda. I have a motion to approve the agenda.
I'll make that motion.
Motion by Brewer.
I'll second.
Second by Fleming to approve the agenda. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And we also have minutes from our January 4th meeting. So everybody had a chance to take a look at those. Anybody have questions or corrections on those minutes? If not, I will declare those minutes to be approved. Item six on our agenda, public comment. Do we have any member of the public here in person or online that wants to comment for this meeting?
Mr. Chairman, would you slight adjustment rules and let me make a public comment in regards to what? A personal privilege.
Okay, if it's not related to a future agenda item that we have on the agenda already, then okay, yeah.
What a personal privilege.
Okay.
Since this is probably, we're approaching the last meeting, I just want to say a few words of gratitude to the experience I've had in meeting and growing to know and appreciate each of you on this committee, as well as the board as a whole. I've not only grown to appreciate the important characteristics about each of you, but I feel a respectful friendship for each one of you. And I want to thank you all for your patience with me and your kindness to me, particularly in the last year or so with my difficulties. And I also want to say that this has been a very rewarding experience for me to be associated with such very fine people over these 12 years that I've been on board, and an experience that I will always remember very positively. So I want to thank you all for your friendship and for honoring me with your presence.
Thank you, Mr. Steve. We appreciate your service and your passion. We certainly wish you the best moving forward, and look forward to, you know, a couple more meetings here where we still have you around.
Well, you know, I'm 81. I said to my wife this morning, you know, I said I'm the same age as Joe Biden. And she said, yeah, and I'm the same age as Donald Trump.
Sets up for an interesting dynamic for your household.
Yes, it is.
Thank you, Mr. Steve. Any other public comment?
Thank you for allowing me to intervene.
All right, then we will move on to item number seven, discussion and possible action, revisions to the Richland County rules of the board. And hopefully if your iPad's updated in your folder, you should have an updated draft that Andy sent.
Andy sent, yep.
Mr. Gresh, I'll let you talk about what we have there.
So the draft that Andy sent is conducive to the last meeting, and it has, you know, changes that are made based on the conversation. There are still some items, as you can see, that are a little bit in question. So that's there. Those are things that we need to look at and either confirm or not. He's got language in red that he's added or stricken out. So that's really where that's at. And then the piece on whether we're going to have a committee on committees, or we're going to go back to the more traditional way of the board or the chair making the appointments to the committee. So that language is in there. Let's see. Talking about the committee on committees, that's all there.
Did you, Administrator Gresh, would you like me to go over the list of things we talked about last time so we can
work
on their attention?
That would
say almost a minute.
Yes, that'd be great.
All right. So if you go to section two, we're going to start with 2.02 and then E. So this was for, let's see, the paper copies of that, so 2.2E. You can see where he's got it, oh, mine's in color. Did it save as color? It should have a red on your guys' screen. It's blue.
Oh, it's red on mine, it's blue on yours.
Some of ours is, we can't read it because there's like lines of.
I see that, yeah, but that's.
So you're talking about the E that's crossed out and is now blue?
Oh, I may, yeah, maybe. Yeah, I just said, oh, yeah, so my notes were, would have been from the birth of the minutes last time, so. In that section, we talked about removing the E for paper copies, so you'll remember the $10, we strike that. So I believe that adjustment was made.
Yep.
And then the other adjustment in the old version was 2.04, which was about the committee on committees, and the administrator press just mentioned those, so there's language in there updated for that. And then along in the same number two there, we talked about the consensus to have no term limits. So remember, we didn't officially vote on any of this stuff, it was just consensus or thoughts, so that's how the minutes are going to reflect it. That was section 2.05, and so that got us through section two. So those are the changes that we discussed in section two. There was also under the previous 2.12B, that was when a vacancy is created, that individuals would have an amount that's less than 10 minutes to say why they should be on the board. So that language should be reflected in there, and again, I'm sorry, but my numbers are just different because the numbers have changed a bit. And there was also in section four, that referenced Robert's Rules of Order as the parliamentarian guideline, and that's essentially saying that the Corporation Council would serve as the parliamentarian for all council board meetings. I think everyone was in agreement with that, and we would defer to Corp Council anyway. And then, of course, the big one was the remote attendance. So again, in section four, determining how you folks want that to be listed out in the rules. It was the previous 4.03, so I know there was quite a bit of discussion on how people can attend, how they can't, as Bob just found it online. And then also the last item I had was rule 10 was deleted in its entirety. I think you agreed that it didn't just be in there, and there's been a few discussions about that, so I won't go on about that anymore. But those are the notes that I took from Andy's revisions last time, and it should be reflected in this document. My apologies if the numbers are different, but those were the highlights that I had in this report.
Because he read them.
Rule 10 had to do with the creation of the committees or construction of the committee.
No, that was postponing motion, making motions and language for that.
Supervisor Blaster, any questions?
No.
Okay, so that's where we sit. So this is looking much better than our first couple of copies. The changes and the edits are getting down there. I know I have had several board members that still have strong opinions one way or the other on the attendance issue and the remote attendance issue. So I think that will be a subject at the meeting on the 12th that you'll have to, I would encourage all of you to have your thoughts ready and be willing to articulate that, because I think that's going to be one of those. I know there are several board members that do feel like there should be some requirement for in-person attendance, especially at board meetings. I feel like I haven't had as much input on committee level meetings, subcommittee level meetings. I think, you know, if you can make that or you attend those remotely or whatever, fine. But I do have some members that have come and said, you know, that means a board member could be elected and never ever have to set foot into a room. And is that really representing our constituents if we're never physically in a board meeting or in the room? And that was a good point. I mean, that was a good perspective.
Yeah.
So that's the feedback I'm getting on that piece of it, on the attendance piece. And also the other, I think, piece to consider is, I noticed the language in here is allowing for, no, never mind. I wanted to make sure the closed session piece too, that whether or not we're going to allow for closed session attendance remotely, because there are some considerations there. Other than that, on this piece, I haven't gotten a lot of feedback. a lot of additional feedback. I know the committee on committees, I think, is a bit of a divisive issue yet at this point too. I think there are some that really like the committee on committees idea, and I think there are some that think we should just let the board chair do it. And I think really at the crux of that, what I continue to hear is that the last committee on committees, like the assignment process was so cumbersome that it just made it draw out. So if we can, Eric and I are working on ways to streamline that to make it more efficient and more effective so that it isn't such a long drawn out cumbersome process. So, you know, there is a way around that to kind of appease both sides, I think. So that's another area, I guess, where I'm getting some feedback. So those are my thoughts that I have on the feedback that I've received and the areas of, you know, little contention that I wouldn't call it.
Right, Candace.
Yes.
Yes, good morning. We had some discussion at the last meeting. I think you and I maybe had some discussion of one to one, and then I think there was a discussion at the meeting about the, and I'm wondering if that's on the agenda item down the line here or something that we've discussed, but I had some thoughts, and I wondered if you, since our last meeting, had some thoughts that had evolved with regard to the structure and function of the oversight the veterans and the veteran services.
That would be committee structure. That's the next agenda item.
Right.
Yep.
I have some thoughts. I'm sure Candace has evolved some thoughts.
So any, on that piece for me, any additional feedback for me, anything you would like me to further research or information you'd like me to gather to have prepared for the 12th?
So on that remote attendance issue, I don't remember what Attorney Phillips said as far as, you know, where other counties kind of fall on that once we have addressed that. I'm just wondering, I wonder if it would help if there was some sort of stipulation in that, that there was a certain percentage of meetings per term that you need to attend in person. You know what I'm saying? So like, so that it gives some leeway for people who need the access for work or for trips, but then you aren't running into that situation where someone is never coming in person. Maybe that would be a way to kind of bridge the gap there. But I don't know if that's something that other counties have thought about. Not that they have to. It's just be interesting to see if other counties have thought about that issue.
Are you thinking of a number or a percentage, like 50% of the meeting?
I would say a percentage would probably be, I would be willing to hear, but you know, people are at different numbers of committees and things like that. So I don't know that a hard number would really make sense unless we were only strictly talking board meetings.
And I believe that is.
Yeah. If we were only talking board meetings, then sure, we could say like you have to attend 6 in person or whatever.
And I do believe that was the intent around the conversation that has been had with me. It was more the county board meetings, okay. Not the committee or subcommittee, okay. You know.
So I didn't get that impression when we were talking about it. I kind of assumed we were talking about all meetings entirely. So
yeah, I don't think we differentiated when we were having a meeting.
No,
but you're saying the concerns came in, it was specifically related to county board meetings.
Okay. I thought that there was some discussion with regard to committee attendance that the discussion about the committee chairman or that committee having a discussion with the county chair or the rules committee, personnel committee, regard to absence. That's a problem for a committee member.
I know they've had discussions about our board rules as far as people who don't attend meetings. I don't think it was specifically related to virtual attendance in that regard, but
that was going to be my next question, Mr. Yeah. Chair. If we would say an actual number, that kind of lends us to the discussion of, well, do we have a specific number that they have to attend? Because have we ever said a board person has to attend this amount of meetings?
We don't have it in that way, but we had a rule that talks about if someone is in a pattern of failing to attend meetings, right, then there's a provision that the board chair could potentially take action
to remove
them.
Have a conversation.
Yes. And I know we've We've had concerns about that in a couple of instances in the past, and Marty would remember this, where it was a committee situation where we had a person appointed to a committee who wasn't attending hardly at all. I don't know if we've ever had that come up, full board type of concern, but, you know, I know discussions that I heard regarding the remote attendance and board meetings was, could we say, you know, no more than like three in a row virtual or something like that, as opposed to a percentage or as opposed to a minimum number?
I also think that it's worth considering absence due to illness or hospital.
Well, and that's absence versus virtual attendance.
Or lack of attendance.
And I would certainly say that whatever policy we come up with, we want to have an exception for, you know, emergency situations. If someone has COVID, do we want them sitting next to us at a board meeting?
Yeah.
Now, even if they attended their three virtual meetings and they are ill, they could still participate because they're functional, but do we want them in the room with us, you know?
Right.
And that, I think, could fall under a chair's discretion to be able to make common sense exceptions like that.
Declare them persona non grata.
Ingrid, go ahead.
I just want to clarify, I'm not advocating to say that members have to attend a certain number of meetings to be a board member. I don't personally like that kind of language. I just was saying, if we're going to assign a number, then that kind of lends itself to that discussion. So I think your idea too of the three in a row would maybe be, anyways, there's some possibilities of ways that we could put some language in there that might satisfy the concerns.
And the other part is, okay, if you set the parameter, well, what if someone doesn't comply with the parameter, what happens then?
Right.
Making sure we have that addressed.
And I'll just make one comment. The county, Richland County would not have been able to function during the pandemic and post-pandemic without the virtual meeting access.
Absolutely, very.
I was, being old school, I was opposed to it. However, I've come around to the conclusion that that's the way it is. It's the way people do business.
Well, now we're going to have an outbreak of virtual.
And there could be any number of situations that come up, so.
Yes, Connor Taylor. Just thinking about the remote attendance, obviously, yes, we need to accommodate virtual meetings. That's the world we live in today. I think specifically for county board of all meetings, as you all have said, it does need to be monitored. And I think that the conversation ended last time with Andy was that there would be a degree of flexibility worked into the remote attendance policy for specifically county board meetings. I, like you, Andrew, was under the impression it was all committee meetings, and I know I spoke with Candace about this, like, how are we going to keep track of all these people? And then that's when we were like, it's just county board. So that makes the most sense. That's where you representing your constituents in the broadest category. For me, the simplest way to administer that or keep track of attendance from administration standpoint is simply to say, you know, you have to attend in person a percentage of meetings. So 75% of meetings, the other three, you can attend virtually however you want to. You clear that with the board chair, and then it's very easy to track. Okay, you've been virtual three times, the fourth time, here's what happens, if it's been approved or not, as Supervisor Turk said. So my preference here, and of course, I don't have a vote, but would be just to define a certain number of meetings that an individual is allowed to attend remotely for county board meetings, and that's the strict number that would help with the individuals for the snowbirds. They know they're going to be gone 3 months, so of those 3 months, you can attend virtually, that's fine. But then while you're here in Richland County or in the area, you need to be here in person. And that would really, I think if we give a very exact number of meeting minutes that you're allowed to attend virtually, there's no question about a percentage or anything. It's here's in person and here's attendance. Use it, it's like sick time, right? Use it how you want to, or not sick time, but PTO time. Use it however and do it that way. That would be my preference from an administration standpoint, to be very clear for Candace and I and keep track of that way. Just throwing it out there.
That would be subject to parameters of the American Disabilities Act.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
I noticed that Supervisor Frank is with us, and he is a remote meeting attender, and I would like to hear from him.
Yes.
Question.
You're muted. I'm working on, there we go, sorry.
Hey, Frank.
I will, yeah, thank you. So the remote piece of it, as of today, I had a project come up. My work kind of gets me all over the place. And so the remote piece of it is very nice. Personally, I don't like remote. The projects I do, I think the one-on-one communication is the best, the ability to see people and have that interaction. But as a situation today, this worked out the best because I also have another remote meeting coming up at about 10:30. So how do we count that? I really don't think it's fair to Derek or the staff to have to, well, let's count how many times this person was here and how many times that person was here. That's just that's a labor on you guys I don't think is necessary. How do we do it? I would say that, I guess there's two visions I have. One is if maybe remote's a different pay rate, maybe that'll encourage different things that way. I don't know. Maybe on the billing part of it, when we send in our vouchers that we put in that it was a remote, so they don't have to physically keep track of that. That'd be something that's the responsibility of us as supervisors, which we should be able to handle. I think we need to be in person, county board meetings especially. I kind of like the idea of at least two in a row or three in a row or something like that. I think would make good sense.
Hi, Mr. Chairman, Mr. C. I like the system that Derek instituted a year or so ago, where each of us turn in our mileage and per diem expense reports at the end of the month. Now, put on the honor system, and you could have a place on there where the individual would mark how many meetings he were missed or accumulate the number of meetings he missed right on his form that he sends in each month.
The issue is not missed meetings.
No, I mean, attendance. I understand that we're virtual or not. And, if you have on Derek and Wormigood, that you have a statement on there that says you're allowed three virtual meetings. How many virtual meetings thus far to date have you exercised? And write it down and put your initials by it, and that's the information you need, right, Derek?
Yes, that is the information that I would need. But bear in mind, we're doing roll call at county board. So if we're specifically talking about county board,
yeah,
whoever, myself or my deputy, will have a clear indicator of
Who's
remote and who's not. So
Yeah. And to be clear, we weren't considering, until Bob mentioned it, we weren't really talking about differentiation in per diems, virtual versus in person. I don't know if that's a road we want to go down.
Well,
we want to talk about minimizing difference work. Well, let's not ask.
Yeah, let's not.
Well,
yeah, throwing ideas out, but I like the idea of being able to have the being at roll call. Yeah, it's a good point. I didn't think about that. It's a good one.
Yep.
Mr. Chairman,
Brewer. Yes,
there are several meetings where it's just we need people there. One is budget approval, of course, and then borrowing approvals. I'm not saying that all meetings aren't important, they certainly are, but for instance, when we do the borrowing, I can't remember the sequence, but one of them to approve the borrowing is a majority of those present, I believe.
Yep. So the other is a 3/4 of all supervisors.
So do virtual presence count in that?
Based on our rules, we have
it. Mr. Chair.
And if we start paying virtual at a different rate of pay, it diminishes virtual attendance. So I am totally against that.
Okay.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. C.
That's all right. Got distracted and I lost my point. Okay.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Ms.
So have we up till now been indicating in the minutes, especially for the county board meetings, whether someone is attending virtual or not?
I have not, because it's impossible.
Right.
Well, it's not impossible, but to keep track of watching the screen and even like now watching the screen and doing this.
I know we look at that and we look to see who's there, and then of course they respond that they're there. I didn't think that it was noted in the minutes anywhere.
No,
that they're remote. The committee meetings to me are mostly during the day. So that's why remote is really important, because like many people have said, people are working or have projects or whatever it is they need to do, travel for work. So it, to me, it's really important, and there's lots of meetings that we've been at that we wouldn't have made quorum had we not allowed our remote. The county board meetings are different because obviously they're in the evening, where hopefully people aren't working. But as Derek said, people sometimes snowbird and are gone, and there's things like that. And so it's good to allow for that, but again, we can't have frequent too often for people. I think it is really important that they're there in attendance for those meetings.
It would seem we want to clarify in the rules that what we're talking about with this, whatever we come up with, is applying to county, full county board meetings and not to committees. So we want to get that in there for sure. I would ask Clerk Kalish, would it be possible when we're doing the roll call, if we could note in the, when we do the roll call, who's virtual versus who's in person?
If it's going, yeah, absolutely. If it's the new rule and that's how we're tracking it, then I can absolutely.
And if we have that in the minutes, then we have our place where we can go back and look.
Right.
And I keep a record internally of that.
Okay.
But absolutely, yes.
Mr. Chairman, just a trivial point.
Yes.
The guy, Mr. C. Virtual attendance, on occasion, not just me, but other board members may on occasion have a little difficulty getting on the internet at the time of roll call.
Yep.
So someone needs to be reminded to the accountant on the roll, even though the roll's already been taken.
Yes.
And I guess it's incumbent upon the member to ask to be counted present.
And I know the clerk or deputy, whoever is usually tries to watch and see if people have joined as we go along. And would note that then in the attendance.
In the minutes, like my minutes today will say Supervisor Frank joined at 9:12.
Okay.
So I try to keep track of that, but.
I'm a little visually clumsy at hooking up the internet, so.
Yep, and sometimes there are technical issues. Supervisor Frank, you had a hand raised?
Yeah, thank you. So has this been a problem, or are we in trying to prevent what might become a problem?
As far as the virtual attendance, you're asking?
Yes, at county board.
My personal opinion, I don't know that it's been a problem, but we have some rather ardent discussion about it. So I think we're trying to address the discussion issue and set our way moving forward.
All right, thank you.
If I could add.
Yes.
And I think one of the biggest things that was a concern for people was the closed session virtual attendance because of the, you know, the liability there.
Yep, we have tried to do that in the past, and it seems we need to discontinue.
I think that's a very good issue.
Yep.
To deal with.
Administrator Pesh.
I think the both.
Administrator Pesh, go ahead.
I was just going to add that I think there was concern by some members on the lack of attendance by certain members of the board. I do think that they have noticed, especially when, you know, we're wondering, like Marty said, for certain critical votes, are we going to have enough people present to vote?
Yep.
And that's where we're running into those issues. I mean, and at the committee level as well, we are having trouble making quorum. I mean, I've seen several meetings have to be canceled because.
You mean committee meetings?
Yes, committee meetings, because people aren't showing up. You know, this isn't applying to that, but, you know, it may come down to that if we continue to have issues making quorum. But this new revised structure too, I do believe, would significantly reduce the amount of meetings, and it may make it easier for everyone to be able to attend because they're not going to 10 different meetings in a month. They're maybe only having to go to 2 or 3. So that's another kind of purpose of condensing the committee structure. And that may make some of this go away on its own. So.
Let's proceed.
Well, I was so distracted by the eloquence of Candace that I'm distracted.
Okay.
So I think she covered them.
All right. Any other issues with the board rules? Do we want to say no more than 3 in a row as far as virtual attendance? Are we comfortable with that 4?
I think.
Are we deciding on that today?
Well, we're going to put it in as a suggestion, and it'll come to the next meeting.
And like that, one point I'd like to make about this.
Mr. Steve, go ahead.
And that was the point I just missed. Someone was very adamant at the last meeting about someone being on vacation in out of state for 3 months in a row. And I thought that was a little unfair. A person can call in and attend virtually for 3 months in a row. I don't see anything wrong with that. This is, as you and Bob, for example, have professional employment, which require you to be away and not be able to attend in person. Those are, I think, you both make valuable contributions to the board, as does the person, I'm sure, who called us from Phoenix. And so I think let's not be too negative about that. I think we need to have room for a little bit of flexibility.
Okay, your point is taken. Mr. Brewer, you have a comment?
No, I agree with Mr. Siegel.
Okay, very good. All right, so are we comfortable? 4 then is our starting point for the next discussion on the 12th. And see what folks think of that.
Mr. Chair, may I just?
Yes.
So clarifying that in the rules of the full county board, or in the rules that this applies only to full county board for attendance purposes, no more than 4 virtual meetings per calendar year.
Was that in a row or was that?
Yeah, do we want to say in a row or do we want to say per calendar year?
It's in a row.
In a row is the way I said it.
In a row.
That's what we have to go with.
So, okay, so that means that if they miss 4 meetings in a row one time, they can miss 4 meetings in a row later on in that.
Yes, that's a good point.
So that.
I mean, can I just revise it again if we have to?
Well, I mean, if you just say miss 4 meetings, then it doesn't matter if they're in a row or if they're just, you have 4 meetings. However you choose to utilize them, if you're.
Virtually attend?
Yes.
Okay, but that is, I guess, okay. I was thinking, you know, 50% of meetings seems like a reasonable number because if they're not like gone, I don't know. Whatever. Never mind.
I picked 4 because most snowbird stints, 4 month stretch is about the max.
So that would be like.
That gives the autonomy for that. And then.
Or we could say you must attend at least 50% of the full board meetings in person and no more than 4 in a row virtual.
Perfect.
We said that.
Okay.
Would that must attend at least 50% of county board meetings in person per calendar year.
Okay.
And no more than 4 in a row virtual.
So 50% in person and only 4 virtual?
Yes.
No, only no more than 4 in a row.
Oh, no, okay. No more than 4 in a row virtual.
Yeah.
And then you're going to clarify.
But Mr. Siegel.
The closed session applies to all.
Yeah, we would not, you're not able to participate virtually in a closed session.
Whether the exception made by the chair?
The chair would have expressed to make an exception.
For closed session?
No.
No.
The under parameter.
And. Mr. Chair.
Yes, Mr. Brewer.
I would think though, those rules don't apply to chair and vice chair. I can't see.
The chair or vice chair attending in person. Yeah, I think that's in other parts.
It says that you cannot chair if you're virtual. Unless the whole meeting.
All right, that's good.
Yep.
Mr. Chair.
Chair, I have a question.
Hold on, Mr. Siegel.
So you had just stated that if for closed session, it couldn't be remote. So if somebody was remote, they'd have to be bumped off the call.
Correct.
What happens if that makes it so it's not quorum then? So then the closed session.
We don't have quorum.
So you could have quorum through that part, then the closed session just couldn't occur for that meeting.
That would be what we would wind up with.
Well, I just wanted to point that out a bit.
Wouldn't it be, it could occur, but no action could be taken after the fact.
Right. That's possible. We have to clarify, Mr. Wendell.
Yeah, we have to check on.
Just wanted to bring that up, that that could be an issue.
Mr. Chair. Just a minute, Mr. Siegel. Mr. Frank had a question first.
Yeah, thank you. So what is the concern with closed session and virtual? Can't we do?
Concern is we don't know who's in the background. Like in your situation, if somebody were walking behind you or in the room, we don't have any control over that.
Got it. Okay.
Not that any board member is going to be acting nefariously or trying to spread stuff, but it could unintentionally, you know, disclose confidential stuff and we don't want to have that.
They say that only 2 people keep a secret if one of them is dead.
Good challenge.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr.
I have a question.
Yes.
Who is responsible for chairing the meeting in the absence of the chair and the vice chair?
I believe our rules address that the board would select a person to act as chair in that eventuality. There is something in the rules about that.
Oh, right.
All right.
Chair, may I just?
Yes.
One more thing. Okay, so I think designating 50% in person and no more than 4 in a row virtual, it just seems to be, can we just, it is impossible just to simplify it and say 4 virtual meetings? I mean, do we have, if they're in a row, then it's like, if there's meetings where we have, if there's years where we have extra board meetings that aren't scheduled like we have now, then that number changes. So just for basic, simple, is there anything wrong with just saying you get 4 meetings to attend virtually or whatever that number is, and you attend those as you need to? I mean, because whether you say 50% in person or 4 virtual, it doesn't, the point is you want people to be there. So for, yes, if 4 meetings is still more than 50%, then why can't we just say 4, you can attend meetings, 4 virtual meetings a year?
But 4 isn't more than 50%. There's a, I mean, it'd be at least 6.
Yeah.
So I just feel like.
6. And you're right, though, if we have additional meetings, well, then our percentages start.
Right. So I feel like capping it at 4 is, I just want to give leeway, I guess. So yeah. I would be more comfortable saying 4 in a row than I would be saying 4 completely.
Mr. C.
I think it should be specifically defined that the 6 meetings, the limit of 6 meetings or whatever limit we're going to have, in excess of that with the permission of the chair.
I think that language is already in there. It's something about the chair making an exception. So we should be covered with that.
For clarification, we officially have 11 board meetings per year.
Well, officially, but then this year we've had a few extra.
Right.
And if, yeah.
Well, Mr. Chair, yes. And I would anticipate with the campus the way it is and some of the other big decisions that we have coming, I would honestly anticipate that we may want to have more committee of the whole meetings to address some of those items.
So what if the language says something like 50% of the, what would that be, regularly, you know, the language of like.
So the total number.
No, not total number, because that could change. I'm saying like we normally have 11 board meetings a year. So extra meetings then wouldn't count into that percentage or something.
Well, then again, Mr. Chair.
Oh,
yes.
Getting to be difficult.
Right.
4 in a row.
It's that's, you know, we're trying to achieve the desired result with not making it really crazy for, yes, record keeping.
Yes. Right. Yes.
And that's where that balance is going to come in of that language. And so again, this doesn't have to be decided today. You know, we have until the 12th. So ponder it some more. If you have other thoughts and ideas or suggestions, you know, send them our way or bring them to the meeting on the 12th. Because we're working through it. I mean, if you want to get more towards that 50% goal, then I think that you need to say 5 or 6, yes, meetings.
Mr. Frank.
Yeah, thank you. So I was just going right down that path. We've been talking 4, we've been talking 6. How about 5 meetings virtual? End of statement.
We're having an auction. Mr. C.
There's always the ability to suspend the rule for a specific occasion.
That would be true, yes. All right, are we okay to move on?
Yes. Wait,
I see a thumbs up. Is your hand still up, Bob? Bob says move on.
Move on, yeah, I'm sorry. That was just a move on suggestion.
Okay. All right, so item number 8 on our agenda, discussion of possible action revisions to the Richland County Board Committee structure. And we have an individual.
So what you have in front of you, as I said, is just kind of the initial draft of what I'm working through for the 12th. But I know the last visual, we were not necessarily prepared to have presented that evening, and it caused confusion. So this one will hopefully clarify what we're looking at. And so what you have in front of you is the new proposed makeup.
Yes, yes, that's it.
Correct. The items in red, those are subcommittees. So the, you know, Simons, the Tri-County Airport, the Joint Ambulance Committee, the Pine Valley Committee, the Fair Committee, and the Parks and Trails Commission, or committee, sorry. Those are subcommittees. The rest are all just standing committees. And that is the reporting structure of where everyone would go to try to make everything flow a little more efficiently and effectively. And not make things go through multiple committees before getting to county board level. So to try to clean it up a little bit. So the next page, if you flip it over, on the back, it's got the executive committee structure. And so this is just delineating that the home, you know, the central committee here is the executive committee. Underneath, again, are the three subcommittees that would report to the executive committee. At the top, these are the departments that would then report to the executive committee.
We talk about reporting, it's in the sense of connectedness, not in the sense of authority.
Correct. It's, and Andy likes to use the word liaise. These are the committee subcommittees and departments that would liaise with this formal committee in order to have action taken. And so that's the word he uses often in the documents that he's sending through to us. So the executive committee, then the administrator, the county clerk, county treasurer, the register of deeds, the property lister, MIS, and then Simons, the airport, and the joint ambulance committee would all flow through the executive committee before going to board.
So these six blocks up here, those are the individual committees that you just named.
Those are the departments.
The departments. And what's the next block?
That is the actual committee.
So I have this upside down.
You have it correct. The six blocks across the top are the administrator and then constitutional officers and MIS and property lister. So those flow to the executive committee.
No department.
Those are departments, yeah. And then down at the bottom, we have the Simons Rec Committee, the Tri-County Airport Committee, and the Joint Ambulance Committee that also flow to executive. Those are committee in that departments.
And what is the block in the middle?
That is the executive committee.
And who's composed, what's that composed of?
The executive committee is going to be comparable to right now what we have as finance and personnel.
Okay.
It's going to be the chair, the vice chair, the chairs of the other committees, and then some at-large board members to round out a total of 9, I believe, is what we were looking at. So
These are not department here.
Nope, not down there, not the yellow ones.
No, up above.
Up above.
The constitutional officers.
They are, but the property lister and MIS would be.
They're departments that have.
Yeah, those two departments plus the constitutional officers.
Correct. And the administrator.
Yeah. And then you have another page here.
We haven't got to, yep. And
back here.
That's the big chart. That is the county board and then the 5 standing committees and then other committees below that flow through those standing committees.
Well, it was my understanding from Mr. Phillips that, you know, we're talking about standing committees, ad hoc committees, and boards and commissions, and that all committees other than boards and commissions and temporary ad hoc committees are standing committees.
No, that you're confusing that what he said. So he said you have 3 categories. You have standing committees,
yes.
Ad hoc committees, and then what he called organizational committees. So the commissions, like the Veterans Commission, really is more like an ad hoc committee because it's not required to meet monthly. That Veterans Commission, by law, is only required to meet 2 times per year. So that doesn't fall underneath any of these because it doesn't report to anyone. You're right. That has to be a standalone. It never should have been combined with any other committee per the law.
I question whether or not it's, you say it's not a standing committee.
It is not.
Is that an opinion?
No, that is per statute. It is not a standing committee.
I don't see that in the statute.
It's not, it's required to be a standalone commission. Meeting 1 to 2 times per year, or minimum of 2.
Do you call the you say not a standing committee, but an ad hoc committee?
Because it's an ad hoc is because it's not required to meet routinely. It's required to meet when necessary.
Okay, that's true. They only meet when they're necessary for one limited purpose.
Correct. And that's what, that's why it would more fall underneath that category than a standing that needs.
I got that now. Who would they report to?
So the veterans, that is, again, it's a standalone. It's three citizen members.
Yes, yes.
Or two members, period. I guess it's not citizen because it has to be three veterans residing in the community.
That's right.
And so there could be a point in time where we have no veterans on our board.
They don't have to be board members.
They do not, correct. They do not have to be board members.
In fact, board members, really, it's much cleaner if they're not board members. Because board members sometimes are put in a position, say they're on an oversight committee, in a position of dealing with county government issues, like personnel matters, advising the administrator on other county government issues that may be discussed or come before them when they, if they should be meeting with the Veterans Service Office. There's a clear distinction between the functions of the veteran, as you say, the Veterans Commission, which only deals with veterans issues and those specific issues of need, and then a body which deals with county government issues. And this has been the problem over the years, is that not over the years, but over the last several years, is that veterans who are county board members have sometimes sat on the oversight committee and have been put in a position where they've had to evaluate or take some action regarding the employee, and they are compromised or in a conflict of interest because they have received benefits.
That shouldn't be a problem moving forward because the employee is supervised by the county administrator, not by the committee. So that should not be an issue moving forward.
No, you cannot have a conflict of interest between oversight members of our veterans and veteran service officer. They must just be board members purely who deal with county government issues and not veterans issues.
I think that's the model we're definitely trying to set up.
Point. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, I do not see in any way that you should have veterans on an oversight committee.
And I don't think that that's anything we're even contemplating, so.
There's a real ethical issue there.
Yeah, we shouldn't have a problem with that with the proposed realignment that we've got set up, so.
Good. I'm pleased with that, Candace.
Chair, this is Bob, and you have a second?
Go ahead.
Thank you. Does this also true for the LEPC at the public safety meeting? The LEPC group had concerns that they are a unique separate entity almost. I want to make sure that that's being addressed.
They are under, I'm sorry, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
They are under public safety. I don't have that slide completed, but in the initial slide, and you can't see this, I'm sorry, Bob. But LEPC is listed under the Public Safety Committee.
But acknowledging.
Okay.
It's its own committee, but I know Supervisor Severson wanted to make sure that that was addressed. So it does meet differently, but if they needed some sort of action at the county board level, it still would have to filter through public safety.
Okay, correct. Just wanted to make sure that they, because they are their own entity for that structure. So exactly. Very good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Candace, may I make one point? Go ahead. It was pointed out to me in a discussion with someone who has experience with this in the state-minded veterans that you could have a veteran who is a county board member on that oversight committee, provided that veteran is not a recipient.
We're not going to have an oversight committee.
Well, the
county's.
Well, whatever.
Administrator oversees the departments. Now, when you're talking about just connectedness, we're not talking about exercising authority. We're talking about
connectedness. I'm not talking about authority. I'm talking about policy meeting. Talking about policy meeting, that body should advisory, be advisory, as I understand it from Candace, should be advisory to the administration with regard to the making of policy. And so there should, as Mr. Phillips said, should have the right to require information from the employee so that they can inform themselves as to recommending policy. No, that's my understanding. And we can debate about it.
Not here.
Well, you can't make this rule on your.
I'm not making a rule, I'm talking about your interpretation. As far as.
You know, everybody gets.
Board members requesting information directly from employees, we have policy in place about how that communication is supposed to happen.
I don't agree with that. If you have.
I didn't ask you to agree with it, I'm telling you what it is.
You don't have.
Mr. C. Mr. C. Will let me speak, I am the chair.
Yes, you are.
Stop talking and let us explain what we're doing here before you say more comments, okay? We have a policy administrator question place about county board members not requesting information directly from department heads or employees, correct?
Correct.
Yeah, that's. Why would they meet with them?
I asked you to be quiet while we talk, Mr. C.
Oh, that's fine.
The way that the policy should work, the way that the information flow should work is that if a county board member has a question or a concern or would like information, they should, yes, come to the administrator or the clerk and request that information and allow us to then gather that information and educate ourselves on the item in question and then pass that information along to you as a board member. To make sure that we're answering the question, and if there are issues, we're made aware of those issues and can then address them.
And that information would be shared back with the committee, but it's not the committee's purview to go directly to the employer department and request that.
I think the committee system worked pretty well when we were able to advise the board about issues that involve county government matters.
Yes.
And nobody is diminishing that. The committees do still set policy. If the committees do have a concern or want something.
You're saying that the.
Mr. C, let her talk, please.
Then that is a function of that. But in this case, the Veterans Commission, as it sits now, doesn't have that capacity. Now, a committee of the board does have that capacity. But again, there's still. Because you went to the administrator form of government, there's still a proper way to make sure that information flow is happening and all parties are engaged and communicating.
Well, we're saying the same thing. You're saying a committee of the board. This is what I've been talking about, not the commission.
But we don't have a veterans committee anymore.
And you're going to do away with it.
It's already gone. We.
Because we have the Veterans Commission. That's really what should be functioning. Because
yes,
if there's day-to-day oversight needed of the department head, that's what I do. And if a board member would like information on what is happening in the veterans office, then that is something.
In general, not a specific board member that's called a veterans committee member.
Right, just a board
so
member.
You're proposing doing away with the Veterans Oversight Committee.
There is no veterans.
Veterans Policy Committee.
It's going to be confused because we do call it the HHS and Veterans Standing Committee.
It has been rolled into the HHS Standing Committee, and it's still going to function under that arena. It's not going away as far as us recognizing that, you know, we have a connectedness to the board through that committee. But we as of 2 years ago, we no longer have a separate veterans committee. We have the commission.
Right.
But there is no veterans committee.
The way it was done, the commission was not functioning as a commission. It was rolled into a committee, which is not appropriate. So we need to separate out that piece of it. Now, if the board still wants information from the veteran service officer, we can run that up through HHS if you want a report, if you want any information. But realistically, the information that she's providing is only required to be provided 2 times a year to the commission because it's to do with budget, with Graves, with services rendered or as needed if someone requires assistance, is how the statute works.
This model in other counties? I have not. This is a very unique model you're proposing.
It's the model that Andy is proposing, so I'm guessing that, yes, it's the one that is used in other counties.
I've had discussions with the state, board of the County Veterans Association. And this is entirely a new model, different model.
Well, I'm looking at the statute, and the statute is pretty clear on who has authority over the county veteran service officer. And the only people that have any authority over that are the Veteran Service Commission and the county executive.
Or our case administrator.
Right, and I mean, it's just how the statute reads.
Oh, you could gather enough information to exercise that authority.
So that's, and again, those are questions that we can definitely ask Andy when he's on the next, you know, we're going off of the advice of the attorney as far as how we're structuring this and why we're doing what we're doing. This isn't Candace and Derek going off on a crazy.
I don't want you to think that I'm upset about this, but I have a right to question it because it's so different than I anticipated.
Correct, and it is, it's very different. We were very surprised. When we read the statute and we were having this discussion, we were very surprised at how the commission functions and what the requirements were.
Well, let me pose one question for an example.
Okay.
Suppose that the veteran service officer wants to go to a national convention in Los Angeles.
Right.
The county has not traditionally sent anyone out of state to national meetings. There's no requirement that this veteran service officer should travel out of state. 300 and some employees don't have an opportunity to go out of the state. None of the staff, none of the county board. Where would the ruling come from with regard to that? Would there have to be a policy established?
That, in that case, I would expect her to bring that request to me. I would then bring it before finance and personnel and the county board for approval. That would not be a decision that I would make because
yeah.
I believe we should have a policy that requires that any out-of-state travel needs to be approved by this body, by the board.
Why won't we just have a policy across the board that prohibits it?
Because I would say we have Iowa that's very close. We have Minnesota that's very close. We have states that are very close. And sometimes, you know.
We have an exception for contiguous states.
But again, and there may be, I do see benefit, Supervisor Steve, for training for our employee.
I
do see benefit to attending conferences, and some of those may not be held in a contiguous state.
Well, in this,
and again, that's why though we would require approval. It wouldn't be something that, and sometimes you can get scholarships, sometimes it's fully paid for, sometimes there's a match. So I think that is a case by case, depending on what it is, what the cost is, what the benefit is. I think those are things that need to be considered, but I do think that that would be a decision for the Finance and Personnel Committee and the County Board as a whole.
And while that's a beneficial policy discussion, it's not necessarily directly related to committee structure, so let's move on.
All right.
Okay, so executive.
Good thing I'm getting off the board.
Executive Committee, any questions, comments, thoughts on the Executive Committee structure as proposed to?
Derek, do you have this?
No.
I was going to say, I just wish I could share it with them. I can email it to you, but see if anyone.
We have documents in hand here in the room that Candace is working on getting to Derek so he can send them out to Bob and Mary.
May have already covered this. This may be a really ridiculous question, but I haven't been familiar with these committees very much. Why would joint ambulance be under executive instead of with emergency math?
So the joint ambulance committee really functions as we're a pass through for them. They function kind of as a standalone. But they do have to come through us for any financial decisions, despite the fact that they do not utilize any levy dollars. So typically, the requests that come through are more for money than anything else. And so that is why we put them under executive committee, because it's really typically an issue of funding, purchasing a new ambulance, purchasing equipment, modifications to the building, the operational day-to-day decision-making on how things are going are that's typically decided at that committee level. And they don't typically bring a lot of that to the public safety committee at this point. So that's why we had shifted them. I'm thinking I don't. Oh, yeah. Okay, hold on. I've saved it somewhere else. But anyway, any other thoughts and questions on that one? So the next one that we have. Okay, here, Derek, I'm going to email it to you.
Yep.
Give me 1 second so I can give this to her. Okay. There you go. The next one that we have on the list is the Natural Resources Committee, and that. Oh no, sorry. Health and Human Services. Health and Community Services. So that would suffice as the HHS Community on Aging or Committee on Aging and Disability, Child Support. Those are what would report down, and the only subcommittee underneath that would be Pine Valley. I know this has been a bone of contention, the Pine Valley piece. There are a few things that have come to light in looking at this after evaluating the information that Andy shared on the Board of Trustees. And I'm not exactly certain of the history of why it was ever named a Board of Trustees, but in looking at the statute, it is very clear that we have never actually functioned as a Board of Trustees. We have functioned as a committee, but have been titled a Board of Trustees. And I say that because in the statute, there are very specific items that must happen in order for it to be a Board of Trustees. That Board of Trustees would be bonded, and they would have complete and total oversight of all things regarding that institution. They would make all the financial decisions, all of the hiring decisions, all of the reporting would be done by this Board of Trustees. So when you look at the requirements of a Board of Trustees, we have not met those requirements. I don't think ever. So it is more appropriate, as Andy recommends, for it to be called a committee, because that is truly how it has functioned in the past. It has functioned as a committee. For example, anybody that is on a Board of Trustees should have to take an oath of office, should have to be bonded. They would have all sorts of different duties and different reimbursements that are required. There should be a president of the Board of Trustees that would then have appointing authority of the superintendent of the institution, meaning then the president and that committee would have the sole authority to hire or appoint an administrator, which is also not how we're functioning. The fiscal year of any Board of Trustees is July 1st to June 30th. Our fiscal year does not run that way. Terms are staggered terms. They're required to be staggered terms. We have not functioned that way. So again, I wanted to understand what Andy was saying when he referenced the statute. And so that's why I pulled it. The other thing is that the duties of the superintendent or the administrator in this case would be prescribed solely by the Board of Trustees as well. So a board of trustees really means that it really functions as its own institution with no oversight from anyone else. And that's not how we've operated. And that's not, I don't believe, the board's wishes to give that much authority to one committee to unilaterally run an institution. So I now understand why, and I wanted to explain to all of you why it is much more appropriate for it to be called a committee.
Be clear, no one's suggesting getting rid of it or anything like that, just renaming it how it's actually been.
And ensuring then that the appropriate authorities and, you know, things have been a little muddy, I think, and how things are working and how that committee interacts and liaises with the rest of the county board, with county staff, with rules and regulations. You know, there are a lot of things that we're looking at, streamlining and ensuring, again, consistency in practice all across county departments.
Ingrid, go ahead.
Chair, and I apologize if you clarified this and I missed it, but these committees or subcommittees in red, are they meeting separately than that?
I am thinking they're going to want to meet separately.
But the other ones that are just the departments would not be meeting separately.
Right. Yep. And these subcommittees, yes, typically Simons has its own meeting, JAC has its own committee meeting, the airport has its own. Pine Valley, I would assume, would still like to have its own separate meeting. And then Fair and Parks obviously will want to have separate meetings to discuss the other things that are going on. But then in reality, all these other areas, it's not functioning a whole lot differently than it is now. But it takes us from having, you know, 9 standing committees, I think 9 here, or do we have 11?
No, I think there's 9.
We have so many numbers going around. So 9 standing committees down to 5. And then I don't even know how many subcommittees we have right now, down to 6. And then a couple of ad hoc, and then we have the other organizational appointments.
Mr. Cobb, is this?
This one would be rolled in with executive.
Executive.
Correct.
Wait, which?
So the.
Yes.
Steve, go ahead.
Good question.
And so the Veterans Commission will be a subcommittee of what?
No, they're a standalone ad hoc committee.
Standalone,
yep.
Their own thing. So
and
not
then,
a subcommittee.
No.
But their connection to other would be through
county board or executive. If they needed action, they'd have to come to the executive committee and then go to the county board.
Okay. So that would be their connection to the board if they needed something. Go ahead.
So that was a good point that Mr. Cosgrove made because I hadn't thought about that. Are we, I guess I'd like to know if the board is comfortable having rules and resolutions duties and finance and personnel duties all put into one executive committee with 9 representative members. I'm not saying I'm necessarily opposed to that. It's just we've never historically had that much power, quote unquote, invested into one committee that wasn't the full county board. I don't know. So
well, that's why
I think we need to clarify that when we talk about it at the next, so that we can have more discussion on like
it is one of the bigger pieces that's getting rolled together.
Right.
It is.
Because that would also include, for example, strategic plan oversight, comprehensive plan oversight. That's a lot. I mean, I guess you're calling it executive committee, but
sorry, it's a bigger.
Yep.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, go ahead.
Or maybe the solution would be to increase that number from 9 to 11.
We can't really increase it too much because we might get a majority of the board together, right?
Oh, okay. So
yes. 9 is about the biggest we could go.
Yeah.
It's kind of, you get up there, you get
so yeah, kind of close.
Mr. Chair, if I may.
Yes, go ahead.
I think, you know, the kind of the some of the logic I understand your thoughts, Andrew, because I thought about that too, like those are 2 big committees, finance and personnel rules and strategic planning. A lot of accounting business does flow through those committees. However, as we've seen with other committees, there are times in which you got to kick something to finance and then it goes to personnel. So part of that, you know, condensation is really to move stuff through a little faster, right? To streamline stuff so it's not kicked from one committee to the other. But I totally get what you're saying, it'd be a totally radical different shift. But I also think that as long as we have the numbers of, you know, a fair number of people on the committee, we should have broad representation of, you know, the board as a whole in that committee to make those decisions. But there are lots of times when they have to flow through multiple committees, so this condensation was to alleviate that congestion that occurs sometimes, but I understand.
I guess the other consideration with that is, I assume, I guess I don't know for sure, but I assume that you are saying then that the chair and vice chair are also going to chair and vice chair executive committee. If that's the case, that's another consideration, is that with them being split, you know, the vice chair chairs one, the chair chairs the other, and I don't know, I just want us to like make that really clear at the next meeting, to hear what other people's thoughts are on that, or maybe even clarify. I don't know if you're planning on putting this out before that other meeting, but I would like to hear your thoughts.
So, and what will happen too is, this is the graphic that I gave Andy to work from, but he will then be outlining all of that information in a committee structure document similar to what we have now. So that will help, but the idea was, this was tried to be a compromise after the discussion of the last meeting, where I've heard a lot of people say they didn't want just the chairs and the vice chairs, or the chair and the vice chair, and then all the chairs of the committees to be the only ones that were on the executive committee. And so in speaking with Mr. Turk and having some discussions with others, this is where we kind of thought, okay, a 9-member committee with the chair, the vice chair, all the chairs of the committees, and then the board can elect 3 members at large, select them to then sit on the executive committee, because it would be a substantial committee. But again, it was designed, yes, so that we kind of streamline who, otherwise we have to talk about it at the rules committee, then it has to go to finance and personnel, then it has to go to the county board. And at the end of the day, I think it's really important to remember that this committee doesn't really have power, because it still has to go to the full board for approval. So it would have, you know, a lot of people, and it would have a lot of policy making, you know, level decision making, but at the end of the day, it still doesn't hold approval power, or it can't wield anything unless the full board approves. So I think that's, and that was something that Andy illustrated for me, and then it made a little more sense. Okay, I understand that now, because at the end of the day, the board still has to approve any action that this committee would recommend. So, you know, I see both sides of it. Is what I'm trying to say, but that's been kind of the discussion as it's evolved.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Steve.
I need to be excused. I have an appointment, medical appointment in May. Right, very good. I asked the committee for a refuse. For excuse, and best of luck with your appointment. Have all your stuff together there. Thank you.
Your glasses are here on the floor.
They are?
Yes. Your sunglasses, but the regular.
Here's your wallet.
Okay, here are your glasses.
First there's the gathering, and then there's the scattering.
Okay. Is Mrs. C awaiting your arrival?
Yes.
Say hi to Mrs. C first.
I will, thank you.
Okay, so any more questions on community and health services piece? If not, the natural resources piece is what's next. And that really is going to be land conservation, zoning, and extension. It's probably not labeled. Don't ignore that. I don't know why that printed the way it did with Pine Valley underneath there, but.
Yes, Pine Valley's going to go through natural resources. Yes.
Okay.
It's because there's so much land.
And again, now I don't have public works and public safety are not completed yet, making separate diagrams for them, but it really does flow through the same concept. But I know this big chunk chart can be overwhelming for some. So that's why we wanted to just really illustrate and break down where we're at. But so any other thoughts, ideas, suggestions on committees, makeup, where stuff should go, what you like, what you don't like on this, you know, so that we can kind of tweak it or have those items ready for discussion on the 12th.
I like this model, Madam Administrator, so streamlines the function.
That's the goal.
Again, our emphasis is on connectedness here. It's not about exercising authority. It's not about you have to answer to whatever. It's no, this is your path. If you need something done at the board level, here's your path where you get it that way.
And it reflects our transition, which has been a long process to the administrator model.
And I just did personal discussions I've had with people. This isn't a radical reorganization. This is the next step. We made some progress 2 years ago when we reorganized ourselves. This is making another step in that process.
Mr. Chair, if I may.
Yes.
The other thing that I really kept in mind when we were thinking about this is the several people that spoke to me and said because there were so many committees, they felt so disconnected from the other board members because they didn't overlap with any of them sometimes because there are so many. And so this way too, if having 5 standing committees, everyone will be on 4 and maybe some will be on 5 committees. And so there will be more interaction between the board as a whole, I think. And so that may solve that problem of not feeling like you have enough time to have communication or interact with one another, get to know each other, all of those things, because instead of serving on, you know, 7, 8, however many different committees, you're serving on fewer committees, but with more people. And so I think that may address some of that. Ideally, that was the goal. Anyway.
But that does bring up a question of committee assignments, because I was one of the people who had that concern. And it wasn't that there were so many different meetings. It was that I think there was like a minimum of 3, and it just really like 3 different committees you were assigned to. And it really just varied how many you were assigned to. Some people were assigned to 3, some people had 6 or more, you know. And so if you wound up on the lower end, you might not see a good portion of the board. So I do think, yes, in consolidating, that's going to take care of some of that, but that doesn't address, you could have the same 9 people, 7 people on all of these, or you know what I mean? Like, it doesn't address how are we somewhat equally distributing members across these boards, because, you know, yeah, there could be the same 10 people scattered across those.
Right. And that's where, with 21 members and 5 committees, that averages 4 committees per member, plus then the additional, this doesn't reflect all of the organizational committees. So there are other things, the library boards and some of those things. But that's where I think it was confused too in the last time in the structure. We were counting committees that aren't county board committees as committees. And so in making those assignments then, some people were assigned to things that weren't true county board committees. And so that's why I think you're running into that issue where some people didn't have very many assignments, and when the assignments that they did have, they weren't actual county board assignments, they're sitting on committees with other people. So this will bring that in a little bit too, because then we can say, okay, here are your county board assignments, here are your other organizational assignments, and we can look at that then and equally distribute it to make sure you're right. We don't want the same 5 or 7 people sitting on every standing committee. We want that equally distributed amongst all board members. And that will be our task then, whether it's the committee on committees, whether it's the board chair assigning it, whether however we decide that's going to get done, that is going to be a huge piece of that, is making sure that that is equally distributed amongst all board members, that we're not stacking the deck in one way or another on any specific committee, or allowing the same 4 or 5 people to have all the say across all committees, because we don't want that. That's then not a true board. So I think that's very important to, you know, consider as we decide how we're going to make these committees up.
Any other thoughts on committee structure? And taking what we've talked about here, we'll move that forward to our meeting on the 12th. Moving on to item 9, new supervisor orientation. Something we are planning to do.
We are planning to do it. We have some documents that we're looking at. We're going to revise the document that we have. We're going to add in some live links. And that way, we're hoping that before we even have the organizational meeting and some of those things, the new board members will have had time to research and do some of the online WCA type trainings, you know, just kind of get their feet wet so they understand what they're walking into. So I think what we'll do is we'll put that in kind of a welcome letter. I mean, they'll get that whole big thing, but it's kind of like a map, you know, start here first is what we're thinking. And then I'm also in contact with Southwest Technical College about doing some training, and we wanted to get that done soon after the new board comes in. And we're thinking we would do department head and county board members at the same time and do DISC training. And at least start with that. That's kind of the stepping stone for then moving into leadership training.
DISC training is a personality type leadership style training. So.
I have a question.
Yes.
So I have, well, actually, and I see she's on the call. Ms. Clements had reached out to me asking, and I couldn't, I'm not for sure. I looked back through our last orientation packet. She was wondering if the orientation covered specifically for, in her question, for HHS and veterans, like board members and roles, responsibilities, and the general orientation. I didn't remember that it did. Yeah, okay. I don't think it covered more general, just board, but we didn't get into specific words. Okay, I just wanted to.
I think that's a great idea, though. Once committee assignments are made, having some sort of documentation for either anyone that's brand new or for someone who's maybe switching from one committee to a different committee that they haven't been a part of, I don't think that would be a bad thing. Or to even have a meeting where the department head or the department heads sit down and kind of discuss what they do, why they do it, and offer up any information that they think would be relevant to the committee members. I think that's outstanding.
And I know HHS has done that. We've done orientations for people in the past, but I think what you're saying, just have some idea of maybe in the general, well, the orientation doesn't take place before committee assignment. But I'm thinking, you know, it would be nice for them, for somebody who's brand new and really doesn't know what each committee and boards even cover or what their roles and responsibilities are, it might be good to have some sort of documentation that just gives an oversight of these.
Well,
and I know that's a lot to ask, and now we're gonna be able to get that this time, but just to be thinking about that.
Well, and I mean,
I'm not like, okay, Derek, whip it out.
These documents should be done. So we'll have this, the structure. We'll have, you know, the new, more clearly defined role of committee makeup, and then, you know, so I don't think that would be horrible, because I could even reach out to each department head and say, could you please give me a summary of the functionings of your department? And then we can compile that and include that. That wouldn't take that much work. Okay. I think you could do that.
Yes, go ahead.
What you're talking about, would that be given to all board members then, just for a good review? Or like you said, if you were ever on that committee, maybe you understand everything better. Yeah. That would be something emailed then?
You can make a document up.
I've never sat on that. I don't fully understand function.
We haven't done a really good job of new supervisor training for a while. So even people who aren't new supervisors may not have had some of this stuff. So it's something we need to continue improving in, and we're taking more steps at.
I will say they did last time. They did try and it was great. I attended, but there was not that many people attending.
I think we did a decent job going over like the accounting structure and the more of the process logistical stuff, if you will, but you're right, there has not been an emphasis on what each committee does. So I agree with Administrator Pesh, it would be not a huge ask for all of us to, you know, put together a brief summary of what we do as a department, right? I know we have a 12-point slide, if you all want to view what the county clerk's office does. I think it's actually maybe 14, but I think it'd be good for each standing committee then to talk about that as one of their first agenda items, like, okay, who's under, you know, who do we all work with, and then have those folks come to that first meeting as well, like at the individual committee level, but as a whole, for all of you, that's for sure something.
Perhaps, not even just who we are and what we do, but also how we interact with the group.
Right, because this is gonna be.
This is stuff you'll see coming from my department.
Right.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
One of the difficulties in bringing new members and getting them on board immediately, hitting the deck running, is they're not board members until the April meeting.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, we can make opportunities available to them in advance of that meeting, but we have to really get them seated before we can drive hard on some of the stuff.
Yeah, but I think we can make things available to potential board members as long as we don't.
And even there's, you know, access issues, they're not board members yet, so they don't have account email yet, they don't have, you know, those kinds of things, so.
That's right.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I will say that some members or potential board members that are running and they know that they are going to be unopposed have attended some meetings, and I have had phone conversations with some. They've called and asked questions, and so I've been offering as much, you know, information as I can that's appropriate. So there are some that are engaging already, which is nice.
Yes, it is.
Would it be, again, this is kind of looking for the future, maybe not necessarily by this next time, but would it be possible to have that kind of information, the overview, the orientation packet or whatever, just available on the county website? I mean, there's admin documents. That way, if someone was interested in running for county board, or is, then it's there. They can do their own research beforehand.
Presume the information will be in committee packet somewhere, or?
It is, there is an orientation material packet right now, but it's within our.
Sure.
Yeah, so, I don't know.
We can.
An idea.
On the website?
Yeah.
Nothing in there that's confidential.
Right.
Right. The other questions or comments on new supervisor orientation? All right, then we'll move on to item 10, which is setting future meeting dates and times.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Do we have a date that we're looking at for that training?
Our regular slot would be this, whatever, first Thursday at, and we changed it at our last meeting, we changed it to 9 a.m. to be our regular meeting time.
Are you talking for our training?
The training.
Oh, the training, I'm sorry, I was moved on already. I don't think we've talked scheduling yet, have we?
No, what I can tell you is that I need to reach back out to them, because I do know that their dates are filling up pretty quickly. So I want to reach out to them and just see how soon after April we can get in. So I don't have.
Who's them? Sorry, because.
Southwest Technical.
Okay, because last time, were they the one that did the training? I was thinking you were talking about the new orientation training. Is that what you're talking about?
No, I thought you were talking about the DISC training.
Oh, okay.
No, the new orientation training, we don't have a date set yet.
Okay.
Because I do think it will, you know, once we decide on how this is going to work, we also have kind of proposed dates and times for meeting schedules, so it would have to work into that and, or in between that, I think.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Mr. Brewer.
We have traditionally used the Wisconsin Counties Association for the training, at least the orientation.
And there will be, although unfortunately they no longer located their training in Richland Center, their county officials workshop will be a parade sheen for our area. Yeah, bummer.
Bummer.
That's coming up, I believe, in May, with the date on the calendar. So that's another training session, so they will highly recommend. Those are wonderful workshops.
Do they let only county board members go to that?
I don't think they exclude, it's targeted mainly board members, but I think other officials have attended too.
Because it would be helpful for me to go. Linda gave me her packet and her binder, so I have all of it, but I would still love to hear it.
But it's about county officials.
Yeah, so maybe, okay, yeah, just.
Cows is the.
When is that?
Yes, okay, great.
Are the dates that?
It's May, is it May 12th? I have it in my file too, I don't have it.
Yeah.
Also Mother's Day, double no.
Oh.
You don't think that'd be a great day to do that?
register now.
Maybe the. I wrote it on a note instead of actually loading it on my calendar, sorry.
Davis, I think they sent you that.
There are two different WCA events. There's a district meeting and then there's the county officials workshop, and they're both in May.
Which one's better? Monday, May 16th? Oh, that was 2020.
It's 2020.
I'm in the wrong.
I was gonna say, it's a bridge.
Mr. Chair, it's Carrie. Anybody in the county who is a county worker or like a department head or supervisor can go to those county officials workshops. And it's not, it's intended for newer people, but even people who've been on the county board for years can still attend that. It's still very informative. I've been to like three or four of them.
May 16th is the date in Prairie du Chien. So again, registration's not open yet, but if you want to block that on your calendar. Then give this a district meeting.
Yeah, we're.
Southern District.
Where Southern District is on May 3rd.
May 3rd is the WCA Southern District meeting, and that's in the Dells. Sorry?
What do they do in those?
Not been to one, I couldn't tell you for sure, but it's.
Vote on officials to be on board. They talk about legislative issues. It's kind of an overview. They talk about, usually they ask everybody to go around for like an update in your area and things like that.
Are we meeting again, Mr. Chair?
Are we meeting again, this committee? That's next item on the agenda. Thank you. That's where I jumped ahead to. So our next regular meeting would be the first Thursday in April at 9 PM, if that's what we wanted to schedule. That would be before the next board is seated, so it would still be our present members of this committee. Including Mr. C. If he so chose to attend. Do we want to go with that? Do we have a need to meet sooner than that? We have the committee, the whole meeting coming up on the 12th, so unless something radically changes there, I don't know if we have a need for this committee to meet again before our next regularly scheduled meeting. So if we look at our calendar, what's the first Thursday?
Fourth.
The fourth. So our next regular meeting would be 9 AM on Thursday, May 4th. Are we okay with that?
Yes.
Then do we have future agenda items as we look at that meeting? And as past practice, if we have no agenda items at all, we will cancel the meeting, but.
Do we have to set that orientation date at our meeting, or is that something that could be done?
That has to come from this committee necessarily, so.
That's true. But we could, by that point, and I should have the training materials ready.
So.
Kind of do it over.
Could be stuff for us to look at, which would be great.
Just that way have thoughts and with. Can't hurt.
So board training will be one agenda item. If we have not yet settled other questions, those still can be out there too. Any other future agenda items for rules and strategic planning? Which, depending on how we reorganize, could be the final meeting of rules and strategic planning.
I don't know where we settled on the quarterly overview of like strategic plan stuff. Where does that fall? Have we had one this year?
I don't think we've.
We haven't.
It must have happened before I came on. I know it's been on the agenda, but then we keep thinking we should wait till the new board is in.
That's what my question was, but yeah.
Because I would like to do that. And honestly, I do think we need to have, you know, we need to update it. There's a lot of things that we've been able to tick off. Derek and I were pretty surprised that day when we were started going through the document at what we've accomplished. So I think it may be time to look at some new priorities and some new goals, which is pretty exciting.
Well, and it runs out anyways, and like, well, runs out in like 2025.
2025, yeah.
The other one is that, and I keep forgetting, where did we end on the whole comprehensive thing?
It started.
I just haven't heard any updates.
It's finally started.
Yep, it started. I had a meeting with Troy. Derek, you were there, right?
I did not, but I knew. No, I did. I had something else come up, but.
Oh, I was too, he had someone else with him and it was me. But yep, nope, it started. We kind of have an outline. We have a plan. Everything should be done by December 31st. And then we're also doing that housing study. So that's really opportune timing because that's already going on as well. So, yep, it's going, and I should have some sort of an outline and update from Troy soon, and then I can hear it.
I don't believe we dropped the ball on that.
Yeah,
there was just a lot of.
There was a lot going on.
A lot of confusion surrounding that.
Someone did, but I don't.
Do you have a future agenda item? I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn the meeting.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
And we are adjourned. Thank you, virtual folks, for attending. You're adjourned.